Kurt Gödel once confessed that he believed he was a failure, despite revolutionizing mathematics. He was so extraordinary that Albert Einstein once said he would go into his office every day just to have the privilege of being permitted to walk home with Kurt Gödel. Gödel's most famous contribution, his incompleteness theorem, shook the foundation of mathematics, revealing that there are truths within any mathematical system that cannot be proven by the system itself. Yet, despite his groundbreaking work, he couldn't shake his own feelings of inadequacy. In his final days, he refused to eat, and when he died, he weighed only 65 pounds. To understand Gödel's profound discovery and deep-seated insecurities, we must go back to his beginnings. Gödel entered the world on April 28, 1906 in Brünn, now known as Brno in the Czech Republic, which was then part of the safe and stable Austro-Hungarian Empire. His family lived a privileged life thanks to his father's success in running a large textile company. As a young boy, Gödel was known as Mr. Y, always questioning everything around him. He excelled in school, earning a very good in all subjects with the exception of a good in mathematics, ironically. Gödel enrolled at the University of Vienna, where he had planned on studying physics, but he changed his mind after encountering the renowned math professor Philipp Furtwängler, who was paralyzed from the neck down and lectured from a wheelchair. Inspired by the charismatic professor, Gödel switched his focus to pure mathematics. He soon became a member of the Vienna Circle, a group of intellectuals who met every other Thursday to discuss philosophy, science, and mathematics. Most members were strong proponents of logical positivism, the belief that only truths that can be empirically verified or logically proven are meaningful. But Gödel challenged this view. His famous theorem revealed that some meaningful mathematical truths cannot be proven within any formal system. When he was just 24 years old, he announced his groundbreaking incompleteness theorem, declaring at a conference in September 1930, "There are mathematical problems that can be expressed in Principia Mathematica, which cannot be solved by the logical means of Principia Mathematica." Although his theorem is complex and abstract, it can be understood through a simple analogy, the liar paradox. Consider the statement, "This statement is false." If the statement is true, then it must be false, as it claims. But if it's false, then it must be true. This creates a paradox where the statement cannot be consistently labeled true or false. Similarly, Gödel's theorems show that with any formal mathematical system, there will always be true statements that cannot be proven using the system's rules. His theorem applies to any system capable of expressing arithmetic. Even with the help of a computer, there will always be truths that the system itself cannot prove. Gödel's revelation, published in 1931, shocked the mathematical community. The brilliant mathematician John von Neumann immediately grasped its significance, later declaring, "It is a landmark which will remain visible far in space and time." Author Stephen Budiansky, who wrote a remarkable biography of Gödel, captured his theorem beautifully. "The proof itself was a feat of mathematical wizardry so extraordinary that its conception and execution were as awe-striking as the result. Gödel's proof has that air of unconstructed inspiration, of having seen the whole in a glance, like the countersubjects of a Bach fugue that work perfectly together at the moment when they meet halfway through, or the turn of a sonnet where thought, rhythm, and rhyme combine in one perfect word at the end of the stanza." However, not everyone welcomed Gödel's discovery. It directly challenged the philosophy of David Hilbert, a leading mathematician of the time who famously proclaimed, "In mathematics, there is nothing unknowable." Gödel proved this was not true. Despite Gödel's monumental discovery, he struggled to secure an academic position. The economic devastation of the Great Depression, coupled with the political turmoil in Austria following the collapse of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, made it nearly impossible for him to find a permanent post. His position as a privat docent at the University of Vienna allowed him to lecture, but without a salary. He only received a small fee for each student enrolled in his courses. As Austria descended into chaos under the influence of the Nazis, Gödel's mental state began to unravel, exacerbated by the sudden death of his mentor, Hans Hahn, following surgery. Gödel's depression was so severe that his mother feared he'd become violent and locked her bedroom door at night, as author Stephen Budiansky described in his book. Gödel checked himself into sanatoriums where he refused to eat, convinced that the doctors were trying to poison him. His girlfriend, Adele, a former nightclub dancer, became his lifeline. Despite his parents' disapproval of their relationship, Adele stood by Girdle, even taking the first bite of his food to reassure him that it was safe to eat. Decades later, he confided to a psychiatrist that he had lived in constant fear of being arrested and charged after Adele had an abortion. They were not married. Adele was previously married, and under Austrian law at the time, civil divorce was not permitted for Catholics. The final nail in the coffin that caused Girdle to spiral out of control came in 1936, when his former professor, Moritz Schlick, was murdered by a deranged former student. Johann Nelbuck waited for Professor Schlick on a staircase at the University of Vienna and shot him 4 times at point-blank range. Nelbuck became a martyr of the anti-Semitic right, despite the fact that Professor Schlick wasn't Jewish, but was associated with the Jewish intelligentsia. In March 1938, when the Nazis took over Austria, Nelbuck was paroled. Many of Girdle's colleagues fled to America, but Girdle naively believed his future still remained in Austria. Despite invitations from prestigious American institutions, he was reluctant to leave, still clinging to the hope of securing a permanent position at the University of Vienna. However, the Nazis viewed Girdle with suspicion. Although he wasn't Jewish, many of his friends and colleagues in his profession were, and he was associated with them. As financial support dwindled after his father's death, Girdle realized he had no future in Austria. John von Neumann recognized Girdle's immense value and urged Abraham Flexner, the head of the Institute for Advanced Study, to hire him, insisting, "Girdle is absolutely irreplaceable." Scholars at the IAS were free to pursue their research without the burden of teaching regular courses. When the Institute extended an invitation, von Neumann urgently sent a cable to Girdle that read, "Invitation still valid, come as soon as possible." To persuade Nazi officials to allow him to leave, the new IAS head, Frank Idelot, argued that Girdle's presence in America would significantly enhance the prestige of German science. Girdle and his now wife Adele arrived in New York in March 1940. Although the move to America brought safety and stability, Girdle never shook his feelings of inadequacy, believing that his later work, including his proof of the generalized consistency of the continuum hypothesis, fell short of his early achievement on the incompleteness theorem. His psychiatrist, Dr. Philip Ehrlich, noted in their sessions, "belief that he hasn't achieved goals that he set out for himself, hence a failure. Therefore, other people, particularly the Institute, will also regard him as a failure and try to get rid of him." Despite Girdle's self-doubt, one of the greatest scientific minds held him in the highest regard. Albert Einstein, whose office was on the same floor as Girdle's at the Institute for Advanced Study, cherished their daily walks together, saying, "My own work by then did not amount to much, but I came into the office just to have the privilege of being permitted to walk home with Kurt Girdle." In 1947, Girdle prepared to become an American citizen. He thoroughly studied the U.S. Constitution to prepare for his citizenship exam and even discovered what he believed to be a logical loophole that could, in theory, allow a dictatorship to arise in the United States. During his interview, Girdle began to explain this concern, but his friends Einstein and economist Oscar Morgenstern, who both accompanied him, quickly intervened to steer the conversation back on track. Girdle passed the exam and became a U.S. citizen in 1948. The IAS also made Girdle a permanent professor a few years later, despite concerns about his mental state, which deteriorated further. When Girdle was treated for a stomach ulcer in the early 50s, he insisted that his doctors didn't know what they were doing. Girdle was extremely anxious about his health, as described in Budiansky's book, taking his temperature 3 times a day. He craved certainty and control over his health, an inherently unpredictable area, much like the limitations and uncertainties revealed by his incompleteness theorem. This deep-seated need for certainty extended to every aspect of Girdle's life, including his views on the meaning of life itself. He was skeptical of evolution, believing that the complexity of life couldn't be fully explained by natural selection and random mutation. He once told a colleague that the human mind was a computing machine connected with a spirit. In a letter to his mother, he wrote, "You pose in your last letter the momentous question, whether I believe we shall meet in the hereafter. About that, I can only say the following. If the world is constructed rationally and has a meaning, then that must be so. He even completed a logical proof of the existence of God, though it wasn't empirical proof, but rather a logical argument. Even as his mind grappled with such profound and abstract concepts, Gödel was increasingly besieged by paranoia. He refused much-needed prostate surgery out of fear that doctors were trying to harm him. He insisted to a psychiatrist that the IRS was after him, the IAS was trying to take away his pension, and his brother Rudy, who remained in Austria, had been sent to a concentration camp because Gödel had failed to return to Austria as promised. When Adele was hospitalized for several months following an illness, Gödel slowly starved to death at home. Adele finally persuaded him to enter a hospital. During his final 2 weeks in hospital, he refused to eat. On January 14, 1978, Kurt Gödel, one of the greatest logicians there ever was, passed away. He was 71 years old. Gödel revealed a profound truth about math and about life. Even the most sophisticated systems have limits. There are truths that will forever remain beyond our reach. The world of mathematics is filled with profound mysteries and complex truths, but what if you could explore these mysteries and even push beyond them? That's where Brilliant comes in. Brilliant is an innovative platform that helps you deepen your understanding of math, data analysis, programming, and AI. I personally enjoy spending just 10 minutes a day on their How LLMs Work course. Large language models have a fascinating ability to generate text that's almost indistinguishable from human writing. If you're curious about coding, you can start programming with Python on day one using Brilliant's intuitive drag-and-drop editor. No matter where you are in your STEM journey, there's something for everyone and every skill level. Brilliant is free for you to try out for 30 days when you sign up using my custom link, brilliant.org/newsthink. That's brilliant.org/newsthink. The link is also in the description. Or simply scan the QR code on your screen right now. By using my link or QR code, you'll also get a 20% discount on Brilliant's annual premium subscription, unlocking thousands of interactive lessons. Thanks for watching. For NewsThink, I'm Cindy Palm.